Well, welcome back, everyone. We've been fortunate to be talking today in an extraordinary setting. The Hofburg is, of course, the heart of Imperial Vienna. The oldest part of this complex of buildings dates from the 13th century. And we're lucky to be in this particular room, not just because of its history or its beauty, but because it is very soon going to be handed over to the Austrian Parliament to become their temporary home while the official Parliament building is renovated. Our next panel is one that shows the value of thinking outside traditional parameters, thinking widely, collaborating in order to achieve the best possible outcomes. As you all know, the Sustainable Development Goals are at the heart of the development agenda between now and 2030. A year ago, the Business and Sustainable Development Commission was founded to make the case for companies seeing sustainable development as the economic opportunity of our times. One year on, the Commission's flagship report is being launched here at the forum. And many of the commissioners, private sector and civil society leaders from around the world, including His Excellency Amr al-Dabbagh, are here with us. I'd like to invite the moderator and the panelists for this next discussion to come up onto stage. Jeremy Oppenheim, Mary Ellen Iskenderian, Lord Malloch-Brown, Secretary General John Danilovich, and Paul Polman.
Good afternoon, everybody. It's a real honor to be here at the Philanthropreneurship Forum. Just before we get going with this panel, there is a short video. So I'd like the organizers to put that on and kick off the session. Fantastic. Well, if anybody was asleep after lunch, I'm hoping that that has got people's blood flowing again. So the purpose of this panel is to share with you the work that the Business and Sustainable Development Commission has been embarked upon over the past year, and we are very, very honored, in effect, to be launching our report, the Better Business, Better World report, here at the Philanthropreneurship Forum. And thank you, Amber, for hosting us here and inviting and being part of the commission all the way through and being such a fantastic member of it at every step of the way. I am really honored to have with me Lord Mark Malloch-Brown, who is the chair of the commission, Paul Polman, the CEO of Unilever, and in truth, the moving spirit along with Mark of the commission, Mary Ellen Iskenderian, who heads up Women's World Banking, and John Danilovich, who is the Secretary General of the International Chamber of Commerce. We could not have four better commissioners here. And there are others in the room, and hopefully you'll have a chance to meet them during the course of the rest of the day and over dinner. So without too much further ado, I'm going to hand it over rapidly to Mark. What I would say just to kick us off is we are at this very extraordinary time. It's been said on a number of occasions already today. On the one hand, we live at a point where the opportunity to take sustainability to scale, to transform markets, to digitize everything, to address the SDGs through the market has never been greater. We do, within our grasp, have many of the tools, the capital, the technology, the international supply chains that could help deliver the sustainable development goals. And yet, on the other hand, as we all know, we live at a point where there is greater uncertainty and more fear and a sense of withdrawal. And so that is the context within which the work of the Business Commission is launching its report. And that is the context into which I would like to invite Mark to speak and to tell us, what is this commission about, why do we have it, and what have we learned?
Well, thank you, Jeremy, and thank you and your team for the extraordinary work that's gone into the writing of this report. The Sustainable Development Goals, or Global Goals, to use the more practical, less of a mouthful term for them, you know, are an extraordinary global ambition. They emerged out of all sorts of committees around the UN over several years. And unlike the earlier Millennium Development Goals, really do express an aspiration and the beginnings of a plan to transform the world by 2030, to make it fit for a growing population, to create the decent urban environments, the food systems to support them, the infrastructure, the health, education, the communications, to allow the beginnings of a decent life for a population of 9 billion at that point. And, you know, frankly, as one of the architects of the earlier Millennium Development Goals at that time at the UN with Kofi Annan, there is no way we can get there without the fundamental engagement of the private sector, not just of the extraordinary philanthropic dimension of the private sector that we have discussed today, not just of corporate CSR, but of a fundamental additional realignment of business to look at the world of these sustainable development goals as a massive business opportunity. And we've done a lot of research in this report to show how the global economy could grow from anything to 12 to 20, or even at an extreme $30 trillion by 2030, anything from a 10 to 30% growth in global GDP, if this kind of investment and business initiative and entrepreneurship is applied to these challenges of development. But it's no mean task, because it's a $2 to $4 trillion investment gap a year over what we're currently doing. And to just give you an order of magnitude, that's versus $140 billion a year of ODA. So in addition to that, you need a $2 to $4 trillion additional volume of investment. So it leaves ODA as less than 10%. And that's the challenge. How do we get it there? How do we build businesses which are long-term, patient capital, which win the right to operate in environments where traditionally they've been excluded because it's about poor, vulnerable people who those in the development community have not wanted to see exploited by markets? So this is a transformation that we're calling for in the terms of the relationship between business and society and business and government. And you know, that's this report, and the next year is all about trying to make it happen and about building a coalition of friends to help make it happen. And we very much suspect many of our future allies may be here in this room. Thank you, Jeremy.
Mark, thank you. Paul, let me turn to you next. I mean, the chair of the commission has talked about a massive $12 to $30 trillion opportunity, and we're all very used to throwing around these big numbers nowadays. Can you bring this just down to ground for us a bit and talk about how you see the opportunity from the SDGs? What does it mean for your company? How do you go about seizing it?
Yeah, so at a time, because Mark has framed it well, but at a time that there is no economic growth, you look at the money we've pumped into the global economy since the crisis, about $60-70 trillion more. We're sitting on about $300 trillion in a global economy. That is, the real economy is only $100 trillion. Many places, interest rates are zero. We really have seen that our economic process, like you rightfully framed it, is very difficult to get going. And businesses suffer from that as well. Many of the businesses that are here, probably in the audience, many businesses in many industries, will talk about low-growth markets, deflation, difficulties of job creation. And what you see in businesses, that as these systems don't work, the business itself doesn't function quite well either. A good example of that would be the recent droughts, let's say, in Brazil. We're in the home and personal care business. Less people taking showers, you undoubtedly will sell less soap and shampoo if you want to. So be it climate change, or be it high levels of unemployment, or be it food security, it directly affects the bottom line of businesses as well. Now, the beauty with the Sustainable Development Goals is that we have here a plan, 17 goals, that require an investment, as Mark says, from $2-4 trillion, but having a return that could be between $12-30 trillion. And I think the first thing we have to do is get the awareness amongst businesses higher. If you talk to the broad population of the businesses, they've just recuperated from all the discussions on climate change. All of a sudden, it's 17 goals, 169 targets. That's overwhelming. So we need to get this awareness up and ensure that businesses understand that it's really in collaboration with governments, NGOs, and others that we can achieve these targets. The payouts are enormous. McKinsey estimated that investing in women and giving them the same rights to education, land rights, financing, could lift the global economy by $28 trillion. $1 invested in nutrition has a $16 return. And so the ability now to measure all these things is enormous. And frankly, on the flip side, if we don't do anything, the costs are just going to go up. One example that the report refers to is the cost of war and conflicts that we currently already have is 9% of the GDP. So here we are asking for an investment of 3% of the GDP, and we're already spending on one item only, war and conflicts, 9% of the GDP. This report breaks it down in four different areas, which is obviously food and agriculture, very important, energy systems, cities, and health and well-being. And these four buckets cover actually the bulk of the development goals, if you look at it. And within that, they identify about 60 hotspots that people can work, and each of these hotspots are actually, not surprisingly, growing faster than the GDP by a factor 3 or 4 sometimes. So tremendous investment opportunities. We talk about moving to the circular economy, low affordable housing, attacking the issues of food waste. And any of these, as you dive into them, you'll see that the returns are tremendously high. What does it mean for a company like Unilever? We actually have organized our whole company around the delivery of the SDGs, because the SDGs you could really look at as a scorecard for the world. Positively, what are the enormous opportunities to create a more equitable, more sustainable world, more inclusive world, which I think more and more people are convinced about. But if you take the negative side of that, it actually is a scorecard of the shortcomings of humanity. And this scorecard is an enormous opportunity. 800 million people that go to bed hungry, not even knowing if they wake up the next day, is a tremendous opportunity for us. A brand like Knorr has as its mission to provide nutrition to 1 billion people. Health and sanitation, which is another goal, goal number 6. Many 8 million children still die every year of infectious diseases in this world, pneumonia, diarrhea. Having a brand like Lifebuoy teaching hand washing, we try to reach 1 billion people doing that. At the same time, I can reassure you, it's a very healthy brand. A brand like Dove, which would stand for women's self-esteem, at a time that women probably have more things stacked against them than men, is one of our fastest growing brands fighting that course. So increasingly, I think what we are trying to achieve is that companies would put their business models to the service of society. We don't see philanthropy and business as two separate things. We see it fully integrated. If businesses cannot show that they make a positive contribution to society, you really have to ask yourself, why are these businesses there in the first place? The average length of a publicly traded company has gone down in the last 50 years from 67 years to 17 years currently. And we have to ask ourselves why that is the case. And one of the main reasons is that societies don't accept these companies to be around. The Alderbach Group being around since 1962 is actually a testimony to the sustainable model that you're putting out there to stay alive, to have permission to operate. And what we're trying to show here is what are some of the opportunities in the SDGs that give every company that permission. The ultimate goal being, and my dream is that every company would report in their annual reports truly what their contributions to the Sustainable Development Goals are.
Paul, thank you. So Mary-Ellen, Paul's already referred to the odds still being stacked against women, right? And the power of Dove to help with self-esteem. Talk us a bit more about that issue, and through your lens, how does this report, how do these 60 hotspots potentially create a vehicle for empowering women in the economy?
Happily. When Mark called me about a year ago and inquired about whether or not I was interested in joining the commission, I was absolutely thrilled to do so, because Women's World Banking sits squarely in the sweet spot of two of the cross-cutting themes that are essential to the success of every single one of the goals, and that is financial inclusion and creating, bringing more people into the formal financial system, and women. And we have years and years of evidence from Women's World Banking, as well as many other sources, that show when women have access to and control over financial resources, they, of their own volition, make exactly the kinds of investments that the goals are all about and that Paul and Mark just referred to. The top three things that every woman, developing country, is focused on is her children's education, her family's health care, and the quality of their housing. And that, as I, to repeat myself, those are, of course, are the things that the goals are really looking to bring to scale. So I thought I'd take a little bit of a look at some of those four buckets, those hotspots that the report refers to. So there's a focus in the report on SDG 2, on food and agriculture. So the vast majority of the world's farmers, albeit most of them at the subsistence level, are women. Something like 77% of the world's farmers are women. But only 10% of rural residents, both men and women, have access to formal credit, and only about a half of them have an actual bank account. But credit, while a very, very important part of the story, and there are some companies that are looking at ways that they can support the providers and the suppliers in their supply chain, and I think that's a tremendous role that companies can be playing. But credit is really only one part of the story. And providing access to savings accounts, which women all over the world tell us, that's why they want a formal account. They want to get their money out from under the mattress. They know that's not a safe place. Frankly, gentlemen, they don't really want you to have access to that finance. They'd like to make sure that gets put in a safe place. And they are the natural risk managers in their households. And so insurance products, particularly in the agriculture sector, catastrophic risk, index-related insurance, presents a tremendous opportunity to the financial sector. Just to follow on with the insurance theme, SDG 3 and the other hotspot or bucket of health-related issues. Again, financing of improved health is going to be absolutely critical, and managing health expenses and the risk that comes along with the health activities of a family often fall squarely on the shoulders of women. Paul mentioned the $28 trillion that could be added to the global economy annually in 2030 if we were to reach gender parity? Well, in just health insurance alone, we could move from, in the emerging markets, we could move from the $5 billion of premium value that we currently see in women-held health insurance policy to $46 billion by 2030. And that doesn't even look at parity. That just looks at addressing the growing need and the growing demand. And I think that's what's so unique about the report and the way the commission has looked at these issues. This is not looking at charity. This is not looking at how we can move government resources or exclusively government resources to developing populations and to women in particular, but looking at them as a market with financial needs to be addressed. And I think this is a particularly exciting time to be addressing these issues because we now have technology on our side. And what we've seen in the ability for mobile technology in particular and cell phone banking to bring previously unbanked, previously very remote clients into the formal financial sector is truly astonishing. And I think even more exciting from the place that I sit in is a report that everybody in my world is buzzing about. It was a research study funded by the Gates Foundation and some professors from Georgetown University and MIT that showed that access to M-Pesa, which is the mobile banking platform that Safaricom in Kenya launched several years ago. I think they're up and running about 5 or 6 years now. We now have very solid evidence that 194,000, nearly 200,000 households, that's 2% of the households in Kenya, moved out and above the $1.25 poverty line purely because of their access to that safe, secure, formal way of conducting financial transactions. And what was particularly interesting is this was even greater and had an even greater impact on women-headed households who literally in droves moved out of subsistence farming into far more entrepreneurial activities. Entrepreneurship leads to job creation, leads to growth. You know that story. So it's an exciting time for the goals to be bringing the financial sector and the private sector more broadly into play. And women have an enormous role to play in that story.
So Marion, thank you. And you know, that focus on markets, hotspots, the opportunity to advance gender parity is all at the heart of this report. There is a risk with reports like this, and even with meetings like this, that it is the converted talking to the converted. We have an echo chamber of people who all broadly, I suspect, buy the thesis in this report, Better Business, Better World. The challenge, as we know, is to take it beyond this community and to make the tent as big as possible. John, you're sitting there as the head of the International Chamber of Commerce. There will be many of your members that will buy into this. There'll be a whole bunch of them that are going, not sure, right? Life is tough, the markets are hard, right? I've got my day job. How are we gonna take this out into the world?
Thank you very much, Jeremy. I'm here, Chancellor Social, fellow members of the coalition, if I can call you that. It's an honor to be here with you today on behalf of the International Chamber of Commerce. And
take a different mic. Just take a different.
Thank you. Is this working now? It is, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here with you today. Still not.
You're not. Is that it? Oh, sorry. Sorry, thank you very much. I'm glad you want to hear what I have to say. I'm here, Chancellor Social, fellow members of the coalition, if I can call you that, my fellow panelists. It's an honor to be here today on behalf of the International Chamber of Commerce, which is the organization that I head, to tell you why the International Chamber of Commerce as the World Business Organization is directly dedicated and committed to the implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals. It is somehow historically relevant that we're meeting in Vienna. In 1919, at the end of the First World War, when there were tremendous changes across Europe and tremendous changes in Austria, we now find ourselves back in Vienna again at a time when the world is faced with many challenges and many changes. The International Chamber of Commerce was created and dedicated to free markets, free trade, and free enterprise, to the creation of strong markets and open trade and all of those elements that go into producing a viable economy throughout the world. And we look at the Sustainable Development Goals not just as development goals, but since 2015, we've looked at them as the BDGs, the Business Development Goals, because business is integrated into every single one of the 17 SDGs. We're deeply committed to the implementation of them and to the dissemination of this report issued today to all of our 100 members, 100 national committees throughout the world, and our 6 million members. We intend in the coming months not only to raise awareness in this regard, but also to set benchmarks with regards to regulations and other thresholds which companies can dedicate themselves to in the coming years as we go through this process leading up to 2030 and the ultimate implementation of the Sustainable Development Goals, the Business Development Goals. We in fact see these not just as development goals and business development goals, but as critical for our survival, our business survival, our economic survival, our social survival, and our planetary survival. So never was there a more critical time for us to thoroughly look at this report, and I hope you will actually take a look to read not just the executive summary, but the report itself. It represents the outstanding dedication of, I think there are 36 commissioners, isn't that right, Jeremy? 36 commissioners, CEOs, who are absolutely dedicated to seeing the fulfillment of the Sustainable Development Goals in the coming years. And I look forward to working with you along with the International Chamber of Commerce. I know we're a bit of an echo chamber in this room because we all are like-minded in this regard. Our particular responsibility will be getting this out globally and getting commitments to the implementation of the SDGs on an international basis. Thank you.
So Paul, how do we get going on all this?
Well, we're about to go to Davos tomorrow morning very early, not to miss your wonderful evening. But the Edelman will be publishing their annual trust report. And we've got a sneaky preview, and it's not fair to publish that now because he wants to do it himself tomorrow. But the numbers aren't that pretty, as you can imagine. And business and CEOs especially are not that high on the totem pole of admiration. So here we have a wonderful opportunity to, I think, to correct that. And it's not the words that speak, it's the actions that will give that. As Stephen Covey always said in his book, Seven Habits, you can't talk yourself out of things you've behaved yourself into. So I think here we have a wonderful opportunity to behave ourselves out of our current state of being. And the first thing that we're trying to achieve with the business community is to get awareness of the Sustainable Development Goals and support behind that. The second thing we're trying to do is to see if we can help companies integrate the Sustainable Development Goals into their strategies. It has to result in a more robust strategy. We're trying to hit about 1,000 CEOs with these two efforts. The third thing we're trying to do is to get to more transformative activities. Some of that you've seen this morning here, where you work sectorally into your value chain with your peer companies to drive for bigger transformations at scale. And my company would be to go together with many major manufacturers to get out of deforestation or attack the issue of climate change or move to climate smart agriculture or attack the issues of food waste, just to stay in one channel. So work it with peers. The fourth thing we need to do is obviously actively engage with governments and be sure that we work together on the right policies and frameworks to move it forward. Then we need to look at financing. The ODA, 140 billion, the cost 2 to 4 trillion. We have to unlock the financing, and that requires a certain effort. And then last but not least, business has to obviously walk the talk. And with this walk the talk, we have a special section in the report on what we call the new social contract. What obligations do you have in terms of paying tax where you should be paying them, fair labor standards, equal rights for everybody in your value chain, et cetera, to be sure that obviously this is a growth model that benefits everybody. So five very concrete steps that we will be pushing as of tomorrow in Davos, and hopefully very quickly getting to the 1,000 CEOs as catalyzers for change.
So there is a question that we'd like to pose to the room as a whole, and I hope it comes up on the screen, which is, will businesses really help to achieve the global goals? And what I'd like everyone to do, you've heard the panel. You have not had a chance yet to read the report, but I know it will be critical reading en route to Davos or en route home. We go from the macro theory of this right down to the micro. We talk about 60 markets, which we think will grow much faster than the economy as a whole, and that are essential to delivering the global goals. We go from those markets and we size the markets, so we don't just talk about them in theory, we put real numbers on them. And then we go from there and we identify the type of companies, the unicorns that have already emerged playing in some of these markets across healthcare, across the energy system, across mobility sectors. There are over 30 of the, if you will, unicorns that we're calling the first wave of global goal unicorns. So we've done all of that. So what I'd like everyone to do is to hold up their card. And if you believe that business can be at the very heart of, if you will, delivering the global goals, you go green. And if you don't believe it, you go red. And depending on what we see as the result, Mark is going to have the final word, because if there are a lot of reds in the room, you're going to have to do some really, really effective advocacy and influencing to get this room to finish the session off on the right note. So, we can have the we may have to move you around the room. But please hold up your cards, green for yes and red for no. If the reds could stand up. So you've got the room on your side, Mark. I can tell you that there are rooms not like this one, where, in all honesty, you wouldn't have a sea of green. You'd have a lot more red. So what would you say to the people, right, who are a little bit more skeptical, open-minded, but nonetheless really need to hear how this is the business opportunity of a lifetime? Do you
want to have a mic? My guess is that those red cards in this room tend to come from development people who just are skeptical about business behaving in the kind of altruistic, long-term development way that we've talked about. In other audiences, there would be a much bigger show of red cards from people from the other end of the argument who would say, come on, business has got its hands full making profit. Judge it by its P&L. And then when businesses are successful, the owners can do what they like with their money, including development and philanthropy. And, you know, in that sense, you know, our message is very political. It is saying that in this world, we think the current model of global integration is kind of worth standing up for. That it needs change. The Edelman Trust Barometer that Paul referred to is a severe indictment of the way that business has, to many groups, lost the license, the permission to operate. So we have to win that back, and we have to persuade the red cards in this room that business can be a trusted partner, and we have to convert the right-wing red cards who weren't in the room, that, you know, actually, if they want to continue with business as usual, they're going to be the big losers. They're going to get left out of all the really big, interesting, exciting business opportunities that the smart next generation of young business leaders will want to be associated with and work on. So they'll just be left with dinosaur, aging, dying businesses. But it's a big challenge, and so just in overtime, as I now am, just very quickly again, the kind of things we're going to do going forward. First, we're going to build this peer group, this coalition of like-minded. So it's a pyramid. We've all got 10 mates. We want each of you to have to come aboard and also find 10 friends. And we're going to build this into a movement. But we recognize that kind of goodwill party-going approach is not enough. There needs to be some real sort of edge to this. And so one of our commissioners, Mark Wilson, the CEO of Aviva, you know, is starting a whole initiative to benchmark corporate performance in ways that every investor, institutional and retail, can see whether the companies they're invested in are pursuing these goals or not. And it has real financial consequence, not just because investors may want a more ethical portfolio, but because these companies, the research shows, outperform those who don't follow these goals. And then, as you heard, and Gavin Wilson is at the front from IFC, one of our commissioners, with IFC and other MDBs, we're really going to find ways of engineering a much greater leverage of private capital into these big long-term development undertakings, particularly infrastructure. And then we're going to try and, in different sectors where we have commissioners willing to lead, and food is one, really work on sector-wide initiatives where the sector as a whole embraces common standards around site, supply chains, environmental performance, et cetera, et cetera. So those get taken out of the competition. We stop the race to the bottom. So we think there's plenty in this report for people to get really stuck into. And that's the challenge of this year ahead of us, to take a report which otherwise occupies a little bit of space on everybody's shelf and probably gets thrown out with the spring clean next year, to instead turn it into a living document, an action plan to counter the political pessimism of today, to say that the idea of global integration and the solidarity that goes with that is not over, that there are some economic means that we can put to work to deliver a richer, prosperous, more inclusive world. And we don't have to give in to the pessimism, short-sightedness, narrow nationalism of so much of today's politics. Thank you.
Mark, thank you. So a few years ago, a relatively well-known figure in the public world talked about, or used the language of, we can. This is a moment where we can, right? The commission is not some closed shop of a few worthy people who signed up or Mark somewhat strong-armed a year ago to come on board. It is an open network. We are absolutely happy to invite anybody from this room who wants to be part of the work of the commission to join in with it. There is a secretariat, there's some wonderful members of the team here who would be very happy to share with you what we're doing and how to get involved in a practical way. The more of us that join in with this, the bigger the movement becomes and the better chance there is of confronting the headwinds and really seizing the opportunities that are described in this report. So let me end by thanking Amma for having us here, Mark for chairing the commission so generously and warmly, Paul for being at our side every step of the way, Mary Ellen for coming on board and making sure we never forgot the angle of women's world banking, and it is right at the heart, right? You will find in our report frequent references, not to the last mile in the supply, but the first mile, right? Because that's where so much of, if you will, what's the SDGs are about really happens. And John Danilovich, who's gonna just take this to the world through all sorts of chambers that we can't even begin to understand. So thank you to you all, and please reach out to us to figure out how we move this forward together. Thank you.